appoint Tim Eichenberg to vote for him. The first item this evening are the minutes from the previous meeting. Do we have any questions or comments about those? Yes.
Only one, I think we might, in the first page on the Highland subdivision, first paragraph states Mr. Stephen Moore, and then in the third paragraph mentions Mr. Moore again. We might just make sure his name's spelled. I think his name is spelled, it's a latter spelling.
M-O-H-R.
Yes.
All right, and just change the first one so it looks like it's the same person.
Also, one additional thing in the Highlands. I want to reflect that I had stepped out of the voting on that particular issue.
So noted. I had anybody else have something to say?
Yes, on page 3 in the second line, with respect to the Rosewood subdivision, I think we mean to say subject to the approval of the town planner. So I would suggest just inserting the approval of. That was it for me.
All right. I had a question, a note on page 4 and 5th paragraph down, that I suggested that one more note for the plan regarding the building envelopes, that they would state that they're for reference. It was actually the building footprint. Do you have any other corrections or comments on the minutes? Hearing none, do I have a motion?
I move that the minutes are accepted with those four changes.
Second?
Second.
All those in favor? Opposed? None. It passes and they're accepted unanimously. Next item is correspondence. We have a letter from the Stonegate Homeowners Association, and either I was too diligent or vigorous in my review, but I don't seem to be able to find that. And a PAS memo regarding Americans with Disability. We also have before us tonight a letter from Michael DeLuca to Richard Davis regarding stormwater review for the Frestacci development. And a memo to Connie Goldman from Sue Weatherby relative to the kindergarten drop-off and pickup locations. Are these new?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. We have a letter to Michael Hill, our town attorney, from Lee Lowry, who represents Mr. Frestacci in the Rosewood subdivision. Attachments to that being the escrow agreement in form that executed, and a new easement agreement from Frestacci to the town of Cape Elizabeth. And finally, a letter from the town attorney, Michael Hill, relative to the effect of the new shoreline zoning ordinance on Stonegate Phase 4. First order of business this evening under old business is Rosewood subdivision. Request by Joseph Frestacci for minor subdivision review, a wetlands alteration permit, and a public access waiver for Rosewood, a 5-lot subdivision located in the vicinity of Woodland and Mitchell Roads, with a public hearing in accordance with section 16-2-3-6 of the subdivision ordinance, and I think the other two are zoning. No.
Mm-hmm.
And 19393A and 19422B of the zoning ordinance. Mr. Frestacci is here. I think you would take maybe no more than 4 or 5 minutes to make a brief introduction, and we'll open up the public hearing.
Thank you. The Rosewood subdivision has been before you a couple of months, and since our last meeting, we have had the site walk to discuss the drainage problem that is being experienced on Woodland. The plan shows this, the new plan shows the drainage changes. That's a drainage ditch from Rosewood Drive down to the culvert, the existing culvert, which will be replaced with a 15-inch culvert. The ditch will be approximately 8 feet wide and 2 feet deep, and we'll try to minimize the removal and cutting of as much trees, as many trees as possible. The plan remains the same, 5 lots, with 4 lots coming in with a private road off Woodland Road, and 1 lot on the Edgewood side of the land. The plan also reflects a turnaround that is on the lot 5 itself and not on the opposite side of the road. And this, I believe, is something that wasn't on the previous plan, and that is approximately 18 feet wide and about 40 feet deep on the lot itself. And I think most of the stuff that I could say would be redundant, so if you want to go right into
the public hearing. So why don't we go right ahead and open up the public meeting, our public hearing. Do we have some people from the public who would like to speak regarding this? Would you please introduce yourself and tell us where you live?
My name is Lee Bumstead. I live on 58 Gowdy Street. I'm one of the abutters in South Portland. And I had a question before at the previous open meeting, and I think I'd like to just reintroduce that. It looks like, as I review this, there might have been some attempt to answer that question. My question being, what is the full site plan as opposed to looking at the first 5 lots? What would be done with the rest of the properties? I suppose I'm particularly interested in that because that's the section adjacent to where I live. I'm curious, I do see a notation on here that says something to the effect land reserved for future development. It doesn't specify where within that property, though. Maybe it does, I'm not reading it properly. So mm-hmm. I would put forward those two questions. One, would there be some value to understand the full site development plan for the site? And two, perhaps it is indicated in here somewhere, and if so, you know, I'd be interested to understand that. Thanks.
Thank you. We have the gentleman up front here that wanted to speak.
Good evening. My name is Tom Powers. I'm an attorney, and I represent an abutter, Mr. and Mrs. Michael Siepert, who are the owners of property at the end of Edgewood Lane. Mr. and Mrs. Siepert came to seek my counsel after the last planning board meeting, which addressed this subdivision. And their question specifically was one in regard to the matter of the extension of the street that terminates in South Portland and presently services access to their property at 59 Edgewood Lane. We did some rather extensive examination of the title to this property and have found that, at least in our opinion, that Mr. and Mrs. Siepert have a claim for ownership or title interest to the real estate, which is presently designated as the extension of Edgewood Lane from the city line from South Portland to Cape Elizabeth. The basis for that claim is the extension of over 20 years of use of the property with a claim of right, despite the fact that the record indicates that there never has been any conveyance of any sort from either the original grantor, the heirs of John Willard, or subsequent owners of the basic 19 or 20 acres from which the Siepert's property originally was conveyed. We're talking about an adverse possession claim based upon the passage of more than 20 years of open, hostile, notorious, continuous usage. The property was conveyed in 1963 from the heirs of John Willard to Thelma and Bertha Vickerson. At that time, there was no street except in the South Portland side. Miss Vickersons, at their own expense, extended that area of the roadway, despite the fact that they had no right to do so, technically. They had neither an easement nor any other form of grant that we've been able to determine. They extended the roadway in 1963, and in 1963 or 64, they paved their own driveway. They also, at that time, extended pipelines from the house to be serviced by the water main, which terminated in South Portland, and also by the sewer line, which terminated in South Portland. That property is actually serviced by the city of South Portland as far as those services or utilities are concerned. Again, the pipelines passed over the land that's in front of their property, which would normally be the street if it were public. There is no indication whatsoever of any kind of a grant to allow them to do that. In the early 1970s, they actually had the property paved, and it conforms almost identically with the street that terminates in South Portland. Again, there's no evidence of any permission or authority to do so. They claimed that property as their own. They continued to do so during their lifetime. The last to die was Bertha in 1988, and in 1989, the property was passed by her estate to the present owners, a period well in excess of the requisite 20 years required by statute. So I think it's important for the panel to know that there will be a claim asserted in a quiet title action for ownership of the property, which is presently identified as the extension of that South Portland street. Thank you.
Mr. Powers, can I just ask what kind of, are we talking about, could you identify on the map what the potential claim would be that would be subject to the quiet title action?
Well, if you're familiar with what would be Lot 5 in the subdivision, we're talking basically about the street area, the paved area, which is directly in front of the property that is presently owned by Michael and Mary Siepert. Again, the dimensions are consistent, as far as the width is concerned, with the dimensions of the street that terminates in at the South Portland line.
Have you discussed the potential quiet title action with the owner of the
lot? We have not. This is only late-breaking. Yes, late-breaking, and we wanted to be very comfortable of our facts before we even raise this matter before this board. Because obviously it is a very significant consideration. If the property doesn't belong to Mr. Frustacci, obviously he can't include it in his plan, which is being submitted for your consideration.
Thank you, sir.
Welcome.
Do you see the nature of the acquisition by virtue of adverse possession as being one in fee of that piece or just an easement?
Fee. Thank you.
Thank you. We have anyone else from the public who wishes to speak? Hearing none, I will close the public hearing. I'm sorry? Yes? Oh, yes. What? I'm sorry. Can you bring your baby up? You have to be at the microphone so people can hear you.
Somebody will take care.
I'm Carolyn Donovan, and I own property on Angel Terrace, which abuts the proposed lot number 5. And I'm not thoroughly prepared to speak, but I guess we have some real major concerns about the wetlands aspect of this property. It is terribly, terribly wet. We have some information from, I don't even, I guess this is the Cape Elizabeth, the legal codes and all, it says that if it's wet more than 20 days of the year, it, this property is definitely wet. It's saturated for more than 20 days. It's almost always wet. If it were to be built upon, I would imagine that you would have to put a lot of landfill in, or I don't know how you'd build anything on the property. And we all in the neighborhood live on land that's it's quite elevated, and yet we all have mildew problems. The cellars are wet, the bathrooms, all of our walls just get very wet, and I can't, again, I just don't think it's a suitable place for anyone to build. I have concerns that if the land is filled in, where that water is going to go. Is it going to go into our cellars, and, you know, what is going to actually happen to the water that's there? I think some of the other standards that are established, like 1939-04, that it should not, it said, will maintain or improve ecological and aesthetic values. Well, I have many concerns that having a house in a wet area right behind ours is not going to do anything aesthetically for our land values, or for the land that's being, or the house that would be built there. It's a lovely wooded area that people have used for many, many years. I would propose that the house be built in the higher area, up in the woods a little bit. It's much more suitable for a house, and I just think it would be better overall. If you have to build the turnaround in here, then all the trees would have to be cut down, which we were told at the other meeting would not be the case, that the trees have to be left. There has to be an envelope left. There's the whole issue of noise and dust and household pollution and the traffic that will be disturbing our neighborhood. The value of our property will probably go down. And the fact that at first the size of the wetlands was designated as, I'm not sure exactly the size of the lot that was designated, but it seems to be much larger, in our opinion, than what is staked out. And there's something in your standards that says that if indeed the town has, I don't know how to express all this because I don't speak this language, but if you've made a mistake in designating the actual wetland area, then things have to go back and be reevaluated. Am I correct in that?
Yes, I applaud you for getting through that wetlands ordinance as well as you have.
My husband did the leg. This was a very fragmented job because he did the legwork, and then I had to come to the meeting. But I guess we just have some major concerns about putting a house right there.
Thank you. I appreciate your coming and speaking. I'll try to address those for you. You have some other folks?
I'm Charles Bickerson. I live at 27 Angel Terrace, right in next to Lot 5, I believe it is. I will say that in back of my house on Lot 5, it's apt to be very wet. There have been times you could paddle a canoe. And I've often thought that if anyone was going to build, I didn't know just how they would handle that wet situation. It isn't 12 months of the year, but it's in the spring, and we've been there 41 years. And I imagine if our house was going to be built at the present time, I doubt very much if you would give a permit for building it, because we have had hauled in 250 loads of fill and loam to grade it up to where we want it. So I was instrumental in Bertha and Thelma Vickerson getting the lot on Edgewood Road. They were cousins, and I had quite a tussle with Phil Willard to get a deed for the land, and John Willard Jr. and I were as close as brothers for many years growing up. So that's how they happened to get the lot there. They wanted where we, the lot in back, but I talked them into going across the way. So that's about it. I remember when they put the, their driveway in. I remember when they put the blacktop in for the road at their expense. I don't know what took place as far as any conversation with Phil Willard was concerned, but it's been in there 20 years, so I assumed that it was public way. Thank you.
You're welcome. If someone else? I know your name by heart.
Okay, my name is Kane. My name is Ed Kane. I live on Edgewood Road in South Portland. I would just like to briefly comment that I think it's good that the record now shows that this is not a mere 4 or 5 lot subdivision, that the intention apparently is to continue development at some other time. So I know that a couple of times it's been bandied about that really what we're talking about here is really a mere 4 or 5 lot subdivision. I think the fact is it's what you're looking at is phase one of a subdivision of unascertainable size or dimensions. And I think it's helpful now that the record is clear on that. I'll be happy to try to answer any questions.
I beg your pardon?
I'll be happy to answer any questions if I can.
Oh.
Thank you.
Thanks. Thank you for coming. We have anyone else? Okay. I'm going to close the public hearing now. Mr. Frustacci, if you'd like to come up and very briefly respond to these if you want. I guess we could probably respond from the and question you from the board as well. Do you have anything specific you'd like to address quickly?
Three of the four parties from the public touched on items we've discussed in the past. The future development question continues to surface. And I will respond as I have in the past all along. There may be future development, but right now we're not planning anything. The planning board will have to review anything that we do, any changes to the subdivision, to this plan. So anything that we do in the future, we'll have to come back here and again, public hearing, and people can have input. The wetland area on Lot 5 has been outlined professionally by both Albert Frick Associates and Woodlot Alternatives. There is some wet area that drains into a catch basin that is on the Kane property. And that's on the back corner, located 5 feet in from the property line. And this is maintained by the City of South Portland. As far as the second speaker, Mr. Powers, on the adverse possession, this property has been there has been a title search on it, has been reviewed. Comments and questions regarding the CPET property has come up a number of times, and how it was cut out, and who maintains the road, who plows that road. And there is information in the Public Works Department in their files seeking financial assistance to pave the road and identifying it as an unaccepted way, all right, by the people that had it paved. I'm not going to use this as a forum to discuss adverse possession, and I had wished that I had some comments from the CPETs when I personally called them regarding their concerns and the situation. We're not trying to do anything underhanded here. This is a third public hearing, and we feel as though that this is an unaccepted street maintained by the City of South Portland, and we're proposing to grant the CPRIT's access and the town access to cross this road.
Okay. Do we have any comments from the board?
Madam Chair?
Yes, Mr. Edsel?
Before I even start on questions, could we either take 3 or 4 minutes? I didn't get through this memo that was on the podium tonight from Jensen Beard, or have Maureen summarize the content of the letter pertaining to Rosewood Subdivision to Michael Hill. There's some issues in there, and one of them, especially regarding the turnaround easement, but I haven't had a chance to read that. I haven't had a chance to read through the rest of the attachments, whether there's changes or I just didn't get through that.
Maureen, would you like to do that for us?
The first thing that the board may want to note is in the memo that you have before you, I have recommended, if the board wanted to entertain a motion for approval, that any approval be conditioned upon the execution and acceptance of all deeds in a form acceptable to the town attorney. So that I realize that this letter has come to you at the 11th hour, and I would not consider this any reason to change that condition. In terms of the letter that's in front of you, Mr. Lauer received written comments from our town attorney stating issues that he had with the deeds that were submitted. In addition, subsequent to submission of deeds, there was submission of an escrow agreement, which Mr. Lauer submitted at an even later date. Our town attorney has called me and said he's reviewed the escrow agreement and basically agrees with the format of it. Again, there's a condition that's proposed to any motion of approval that performance guarantee be submitted and approved by the town in a form acceptable. So these are not issues that have to be addressed tonight. Number one under the letter before you is just a typo, and I believe that's why you received that one-page substitution, which is included as the attachment, which is a substitution for one of the easement deeds. Secondly, on the proposed covenants, there has been a lot of discussion about what kind of review the board would have if there were any changes to the subdivision at a subsequent date. There's a provision in our subdivision ordinance that says any change to an approved subdivision plan has to go back to the planning board. But to just give us a little bit more insurance on that particular provision, the applicant has added a note to the plan that any revision to this subdivision plan would have to come back to the planning board. I have discussed this with the town attorney, and he feels that since the note is on the plan, we don't need to worry about the covenants. So that while I would disagree with number two in that the board can control covenants when it advances standards in the subdivision ordinance, this particular covenant we don't have to worry about because it's addressed through a note on the plan. Number three, it's just another question of a revision to that easement deed, the one substitution page which you have before you. Number four, with regard to the turnaround easement, this, I think, is a good reason why that condition would be something the board would want to consider if you consider a motion for approval. There is some disagreement between the applicant's attorney and the town on exactly what kind of rights we need in the turnaround area. I would disagree, and the town attorney would disagree with number four, that if the town is given an easement for the turnaround, that we should have full rights in that turnaround area, and those full rights do have to include such things as maintenance, grading, and snow storage. The turnaround isn't any good if the town can't go in and plow it and keep it open for use by emergency vehicles. Therefore, we have to have rights to put snow in that area. There was a question again about the format of one of the deeds and what was the area that was supposed to be covered for the Lot 5 deed, and I think this is just a formatting question between the two attorneys. And under number six, you have a copy of the escrow agreement before you. I would like to point out that our ordinance requires that
Not only does the planning board have to approve that agreement, but it has to be submitted in a form acceptable to the town manager and the town attorney.
Yeah, number four was the major issue, and I really didn't get a chance to get all the way through that, and then back to the proposed deed before we started. And I read from the deed in front of us, it states that access right of way, the perpetual right easement pass and repass, on certain vehicles at any time and all times, together with the right to enter from time to time within said areas to inspect, install, construct, maintain, repair, rebuild, replace, remove, fill, pavement, and other facilities, pertinences, intended to facilitate and improve access over such premises. To me, that's quite clear that, yes, you can maintain that, you can plow it. It's a town easement for turnaround. I guess we are protected if you say that the town attorney would not agree with paragraph four here. The intent, and I think it's a good solution to the turnaround problem at that point, and a generous solution from the applicant's point of view. But it becomes meaningless if the town can't turn a truck around in there and plow that to keep it clear for emergency vehicles.
Thank you, Steve. Thank you, Maureen. We have some other comments from the board before I jump in. You're not sure?
I guess, first off, I'd like a little clarification, perhaps first from the planner, on this whole issue of wetlands and Lot 5. We had a lot of discussion in past meetings about Naskeag soils and how, according to the town, they're considered wetland soils, whereas we had arguments from the applicant soil scientist that this was a fair breakdown, indicating that this particular section of Naskeag on Lot 5 is not a wetland soil. I don't believe we ever resolved that, and since Brayton, which is identified as poorly drained, and Naskeag comprise almost the entire lot, what is the town's staff's opinion on this right now?
Okay, and I guess I'd like to start off by, I know one of the residents referred to something in the ordinance about having to adjust the map lines as necessary, and there is provisions in the ordinance where you can field verify wetland boundaries, and these have been field verified. If I can refresh the board on that previous debate, the question was not, the town does have the two wetland zones, the critical wetland and the wetland protection zone. The critical wetland zone can be defined solely by soils or solely by vegetation. The wetland protection zone needs to have both of those criteria. However, most times you have a poorly drained soil, you're also going to find wetland vegetation. They go hand in hand. So most people, when they come in, will only provide the town with soils information. It's usually complete enough. So if they have a soil that is identified in our list, in our town ordinance, as poorly drained, we automatically classify it as a wetland protection zone. In this case, the Brayton soil, everyone agrees, is classified as a poorly drained or wetland protection soil. I would like to point out that the ordinance does not preclude development of poorly drained soils. That's a wetland protection zone, and if the board chooses, it can grant a special permit for construction in that zone. The other debate was about the Naskeag and the Naumburg soils. In our ordinance, Naskeag and Naumburg are identified as poorly drained soils. Therefore, we automatically classify these areas as wetland protection zones. The applicant and the applicant's soil scientist disagreed. He argued that our ordinance was not specific enough and that they had somewhat poorly drained rather than poorly drained tendencies. In other words, you couldn't put a septic system there, but it didn't quite meet the hydric soil wetland definition. The response from the code enforcement officer was, well, our definition for the wetland protection zone is two-part. It has a soils component and a wetlands component. You've only given us the first half. If you're disputing whether or not this is a poorly drained soil, give us the second half. So the applicant did go out and hire Woodlot Alternatives to go out and do a vegetation analysis of the areas in dispute.
I believe that report was submitted to the board at the last meeting. Willow Alternatives did use the town ordinance. They went out, they surveyed the vegetation, and they agreed that the wetland vegetation occurred in the areas of the Brayton soils and did not occur in the areas of the Nomburg and Naskeag soils that were identified by the applicant. Basically, what they said is, the soil lines that you have identified, that the applicant has identified, are correct. The Brayton, therefore, should be considered poorly drained, and the Nomburg and Naskeag, in this particular situation, should not be considered wetland protection zone.
And the code enforcement officer's response to that was?
He accepted the report.
So right now, the configuration of Lot 5, as it stands on this map, is buildable according to the code enforcement officer.
We are not voting on the wetlands alteration permit for this area, are we?
No, we're not.
No, it's only in the other.
Yeah, the wet, if the applicant were to, say, if the turnaround that's currently proposed were to extend into the Brayton area, or if the building envelope were to extend into the Brayton area, then a wetlands alteration permit would be needed. However, the wetlands alteration permit the applicant is requesting is for the area along Rosewood Road, or Rosewood Drive, where that finger of wetland extends out from the pond.
What are the town regulations on fill in such a lot? Would there be any in that Naskeag area within the building
no.
envelope?
That area is not regulated as a wetland, and there's no restrictions as to fill unless someone were to drastically alter a drainage pattern, in which case there might be some recourse for someone. In the site plan regulations, if you alter more than 10,000 square feet, you have to come in under the storm drain ordinance, and you might have to meet some requirements under that section, but if it's treated just like any other lot, and like anyone could haul fill in there and not require a permit.
We also have the building envelope here, and we've excluded any alterations outside that, limited any type of activity outside that building envelope area, except for the utility lines coming in. So that area will not be disturbed, nor will the area behind the property. I think it's a 20-foot setback we have to the property line, so all of that will remain intact. No tree cutting of any nature.
I guess I would then skip to another subject on this claim of the Sieperts to ownership of that particular bit of property. I know when I worked on this in other towns that last-minute claims by someone with respect to ownership rights often did not slow an applicant down because we have gone over their right title and interest and so forth in the property. What is this town's policy when you have a claim like this? And clearly, if there's a legitimate claim, we may have some trouble permitting this lot.
Maureen, you answer?
I did speak with our town attorney this afternoon about this issue, and his position was that the board could proceed with whatever actions it wanted to take tonight, that the applicant had proven sufficient right title and interest as we've accepted in the past, namely he's provided a survey stamped by a registered Maine surveyor. So as far as the board is presented, the applicant owns his property, and that you wouldn't want to put yourself in the place of a court in making a determination of whether or not he really does own the property. However, you may want to reflect the fact that you considered this in your findings.
For now, I'll ask one more question. On the pedestrian easement, there had been talk about a previous easement indicated that the applicant could change the location at his discretion. Is that the language that has been changed?
I want to review that again, but it's my understanding and speaking, the town attorney reviewed that language and he's approved it. I believe it has been changed, so now that it's done It actually has been revised based on your recommendation at the last meeting, that it has to be done through approval of the town council as well as the applicant, and the approval of the council can't be unreasonably withheld.
Thank you.
Do you have anything else? Okay, I have a few things. Specifically, I would like to speak to the public with respect to my interpretation of any proposed or contemplated build-out of this and how we can see it from here. And Maureen, you can jump in and correct me wherever I err. As the subdivision is proposed to us right now, regardless of whether Mr. Fustacci says he has any plans or not, isn't germane. The subdivision as it is proposed now is what we are reviewing now. If he is to come back, either selling the large lot to anyone else or himself decides to put more lots in, he will have to come before the planning board. He will also then have to go through all the rules such as the densities, the number of lots that can be put in there, going through the wetlands, and all the other things that he has gone through for this. There's no way that we can limit him right now. If he hasn't anything contemplated, we can't presume he does. All we can say is if he comes back or he sells and someone else comes back, they start from ground zero all over again. I did believe there was a maximum density, I think, that actually could be supported on that lot, and it was, what, maybe five or six additional lots?
I really haven't checked that.
I think I figured it out, and it was... it certainly isn't going to be a 30-lot subdivision. Oh, don't say that. Something else will happen. I have to move to Montana. But we have ordinances, and we have to abide by them. Sometimes I find them restrictive. My planner is constantly urging me to live with them because sometimes I will be glad they're there. Tonight, I'm glad they're there because I can tell you that these are the rules. These are the rules he's going to have to follow. He's going to have to go all through the wetland stuff again, the roads, the access, the buffers, and everything else. And that's all I can assure you with, is that we're not going to allow an unlimited growth there. With regards to the wetlands, I know at times it seems, when you look at something like Lot 5, and it seems so wet, it seems just preposterous, perhaps, or incomprehensible that anyone would want to build there. Again, we do have ordinances, and we have just put in an unbelievable shoreland zoning ordinance and wetlands ordinance. It's extremely tight. And according to the ordinance and according to several different soils reports and vegetation reports, we've had scientists back out there, we've been out there with them, it falls through the cracks and it's okay. And that's all I can say, is that we tried as hard as we could to make practically all of Cape Elizabeth totally unbuildable, but this one, it is. And that's all I can report on that, is that that's the way the ordinance reads, we have to follow it. And that's all I can respond to. With regard to the access, I again, it's an 11th hour sort of thing the Sieperts have brought up. Adverse possession is difficult and long to prove, and you have no idea how the result of it would be. Apparently, I don't know if they're satisfied with the proposed easement that they're getting, but this is something that the Sieperts' attorney, Mr. Powers, should probably deal with Mr. Frustacci's attorneys and start to resolve it. But we can't hold up the, for however long it might take, pending a result of what could be many years of court disgusting. I mean, at the worst, at the best, a court battle over that. I do want it noted into the record that it has appeared, and indeed, if the Sieperts were to win, then that road would not belong to the applicant, and we wouldn't have a road there. And there'd be no access to Lot 5 and a whole lot of other messes, but I can't presume those things right now. I'll have to go ahead. At least I would prefer to. We had some other items, the grocery list. Yes?
We leave the wetlands issue. Can I bring up another?
Go right ahead.
Quagmire. First of all, I think that we ought to recognize that the developer has dedicated public use and access to the area around the pond, and for that he should be congratulated. This is going to be a public benefit, I think, that the town of Cape Elizabeth will be lucky to have, and it's a real benefit that, you know, does the developer proud. Secondly, there is a critical wetland on this property, and I'd like to clarify something with the town planner, if I might. According to the ordinance, critical wetlands require a 250-foot buffer zone unless the planning board makes specific findings. According to Section 19.3906, is that correct, Maureen? In this particular case, the finding that we made was that the buffer around the critical wetland in the area of the road could be reduced to 100 feet to accommodate that road because it met subparagraph 2, which is that it's a resource protection 1 critical wetland zone within 250 feet of densely developed area as defined herein. Is that correct? However, the area north of the wetland area and the area in between that is not affected by the road may be adjusted to reach at least more than the 100-foot buffer zone that we have adjusted it and not impact that road. Is that also correct?
Mm-hmm.
So therefore, in order to address one of the concerns that some of the residents have expressed about future development, we might extend, based upon this section and the findings that we've made, that buffer zone to 250 feet north of the pond or critical wetland area and not impact any of this development, and yet maintain a critical wetland buffer zone of 250 feet at the same time, which would or may reduce some of the density of the development if and when future development occurs. Did I make myself clear?
Mm-hmm. I would like to point out to the board, if you have the ordinance of section 19.3910, beginning on the new ordinance, page 69, and what it is, A through K, is a list of conditions that can be attached to special permits. And under A, it talks about establishment of a buffer between a resource protection 2 zone and adjacent uses, and B, increases of the required buffer for the resource protection 1 critical wetland zone. So this is just kind of a shopping list the board may want to keep in mind of things that they can look at when they are issuing special permits.
So, Maureen, do I understand that, let me just clarify Tim Eichenberg's point. I don't understand that we have done more than is absolutely necessary at this point to allow the construction of the road as it is, and that we have not done anything to, I guess what I'd like to ask you is, do you suggest doing anything in the affirmative to implement your point?
The implication, I guess, of what I was saying is that we might choose to extend the critical wetland buffer around that pond to 250 feet in all areas where it does not affect the road or any of the construction that that the developer wants to undertake in this particular project, thereby reducing the size of the lot area for future development without, you know, affecting this project one way or the other, really.
Okay. Any board comments on that?
My own comment would be that I'm not sure that that's a precedent that I would want to start in this, that the board, with a wave of a wand, moves it from 100 to 250 feet where it may or may not affect the subdivision. I think we look at the merit of the 100-foot buffer versus the 250-foot buffer. I think it's a good point, but I'm not sure that that's a way we want to start treating subdivision applications as they come before us, that for here it goes 100 feet and then there where we need it, so to speak, we go to 250. Good point. I'm not sure. I haven't thought it all the way through yet.
I guess I have a particular problem with doing it right now. If we had come in on the preliminary application approval and all that and had always said it and it was expected, it would be one thing, but when you're... Because for all intents and purposes, it would change the whole thing a lot.
Can I respond to that, please? It is late in the process. It's not too late in the process, but it's late in the process to do that. In terms of it affecting the project, the only thing it would do would change the lines drawn on the subdivision map at this point. And as far as being arbitrary, I believe that it is not arbitrary. It's not changing it 100 feet here and 250 feet there. It's maintaining a 250-foot buffer, basically, with a waiver for the road, which is all that's really needed. That's really all that's required in this particular case. There's no need to have less than a 250-foot buffer except to accommodate that particular road, as far as I can tell from the plan. Is that correct, Mr. Stash?
I think also lot three pretty much become lose all utility.
By increasing it to 250 feet, you're severely going to limit this proposal that I have before you also.
Well, I'm not talking about increasing it beyond the road at all.
Well,
I'm just in talking about increasing it the east side of the road.
Okay. This line right here is 100 feet right here. And if you increase it 250 feet, you're going to eliminate lot four.
No, I wasn't thinking of doing that.
Okay.
That's not what my proposal was.
I think what Mr. Eikenberry is saying is that where there are existing proposed improvements to the subdivision, that would be waived, and where there are none planned or proposed here on this plan, that it changes or zooms out to 250.
I hear him, and I understand what he's trying to do. And it's my impression, and I believe it's through a number of other people's impression also, that the purpose of the 250-foot is for wetlands protection, as it's defined, and not for limitation of development or construction. And I think this is what we're doing with what you're proposing. And it's going to limit me as far as obtaining a financial return on the property, and I'm not comfortable with it as a developer, as an owner of the property. And I think we're jumping on to the next step. And if we come back to you in a couple of years or 4 or 5 years or whatever, and I'm sure that we have some changes in the ordinance, maybe at that time you can ask us to do that. But I think that you're asking things that will cloud certainly what I have proposed now before you.
Okay, as a planning board chair person, I have never been afraid of putting things to a vote. And if we get a proposal or a motion that includes that, we just let people vote, let it go like that. I understand what people are saying, and I'm frankly torn both ways. I get torn on the fact that it seems quick to do it right now at the very end. But by the same token,
It also has merit, too. But why don't we move along to some of the other things that we have? The entrance landscaping, you've removed the note regarding the entrance and added that it would be free of debris and rubble from blasting. Are we still going to have the $2,500 in the escrow?
No. We've deleted that, and through the discussion at the last meeting, we wanted to keep it clean, neat and clean, and not get involved in a lot of landscaping, which would require, and I think we were looking at a landscape architect doing some work, and I do not want to have this thing look like your typical subdivisions that you can see going along Mitchell Road. I want to keep this as low-key as possible. Landscaping is not something that we were planning initially, and it is not something we're planning, you know, this evening.
Okay, so that's out.
Do you anticipate having a sign, Mr. Prestaci?
A sign would be the small standard size. It will not be a large sign that you'll see in some of these other subdivisions. And I do understand that if we come back for something out of the ordinary that the ordinance will not allow, that we have to come back to you people to ask for approvals of that. So I'm expecting just a typical street road sign there now.
So and I don't know what... You're looking at putting up the Public Works, the green sign?
Whatever is permissible, and I don't know what the size is, but it will not be the large two-foot by six-foot sign.
Okay, let me go to a planner. I'm not sure at which point we have to include that in our review. If this Public Works is going to put one up, then basically he's not.
Nothing has to be required, is required to be in the review at this time. It's to the applicant, it's in the applicant's best interest if he plans to put in some kind of freestanding sign, which requires a planning board permit, to just do it all now. If all he's going to put in is a road sign, then that's permitted under the sign ordinance without any permit from the planning board.
Okay. Thank you.
Madam Chair?
Yes.
Just on this issue, I had it marked, and I fully understand what the applicant's trying to do, but the way it reads is a note to the plan right now. It says the entrance to Rosewood Drive must be free of any rubble or debris from blasting, which to me indicates just you have to pick up the rocks out of the roadway. And I think your intent was right, but it just doesn't convey, I think, what you're trying to say. And if I might suggest how I would like to see this note read, that any exposed rock face caused by blasting at the entrance of and in the right of way of Rosewood Drive shall be treated to appear as a natural rock face free of scarring and debris. I'm sorry, loose debris. The intent is just to clean up the rock face. And I'd like something similar to that to take the place of the note that's there now.
That shouldn't be a problem.
No, it's not.
No, okay. I think that was your intent all along.
Yes. We only had so much room on the plan.
Well, that wasn't too wordy.
Okay. Some of the other items that we had. Tree plantings, we had recommended white pines be changed to hemlocks for lot 3. Now's the time to make some other changes if we'd prefer more hemlocks. Otherwise, white pines are the vote of the day.
Just as a comment,
I like hemlocks better.
Well, the point is that white pine doesn't grow under a canopy of overhead vegetation, and you end up with a Charlie Brown Christmas tree type white pine. The intent is that hemlock does grow in the shade of canopy, and I think we were only talking about lot 2 or 3 at the time. Lot 3. The intent was on lot 2 and 3 that they be hemlock. I think there's plenty of sunlight at the edge of woodland road.
I agree with you. There is plenty of sunlight on lot 1. And also what we proposed them in lot 2, there's plenty of sunlight. And I tried to point this out at the sidewalk we had in the lower portion. In the lower portion here, there's a lot of scrub brush, actually, not bushes, more than trees, in this lower area, and that's why we proposed to put these trees in there. If there were higher trees, these wouldn't be proposed for that area.
Okay. The issue that I have with lot 2 is In Lot 3, we're trying to buffer a septic system that's within 20 feet or so of a boundary, and I think that needs buffering. Lot 2, the septic system there is 150 feet from the nearest or the abutting property, the Dragonis. I hope I'm pronouncing that correctly. One board member's opinion only, that I think where the buffering is needed is in this case where there's a proposed building about 60 feet from the other lot, the Earnhardt's property. Just knowing the lay of the land on Lot 2, I'd like to see the same amount of buffering just moved up northerly to come between the proposed house on Lot 2 and the Earnhardt's.
I don't think we can get them in there because of the trees. It's kind of... Is Mrs. Earnhardt here? I don't think she is, but there's a lot of trees there now, and I don't think we can get them in without doing a lot of disturbing of the trees that are there. I put them in. I made the notation to put them in the lower area because there really weren't any trees, and I would have extended them up to the upper portion of Lot 2 if there weren't any trees there. But, you know, again... if you want to make this as a condition to go out and do a site walk again...
I'll trust your knowledge of that site better than mine.
Okay.
We were standing at that location, and I thought that was the concern of buffering there, but... Judy?
I may be wrong, but I remember talking to Mrs. Earnhardt on the sidewalk, and she distinctly said, I don't care about more trees. I'd like the house moved further from my house. And I remember talking to Mr. Frustaci, and I was hoping to see the building envelope tightened up, but she didn't... She wasn't concerned about
the
trees.
I'll forego the comment on moving the buffer then. I think the building envelope that we see right as it is here is sufficient. Restricted in much more, you're going to make it so tight there's no room for a turnaround for a home, or a typical home for this type of lot, I don't think.
Okay. The performance guarantee is pending acceptance with the town attorney in format, and I am afraid I just have to rely on the manager and the planner's feeling for the amount, unless the board has something else. But that $98,000 was the recommended amount from the town engineer. Or have been increased to $98,000, I guess. I'm sorry. Have any feelings?
Madam Chair, I don't disagree with increasing it, but it's based on our town engineer's suggestion, and I haven't bought all of his suggestions yet,
no,
especially on the drainage and so forth, as far as the plunge pit, or whatever, however he refers to it.
That's the last thing I'm going to get to.
Okay. I think maybe we will simply leave it. I'd like to see it left conditional to an agreement of our town engineer with what we set as conditions of the final approval if we get to that point, not set a certain dollar amount.
That's fine. I'm just bringing up stuff that needs to be brought up and talked about. And lastly, and then not lastly, there's lots more, but actually last, is let's get settled in our mind what we're going to do with this drainage thing. The town engineer would have us do all sorts of things. And if I think that, from my way of thinking right now, I think we are very lucky to have Mr. Frustaci and the town working as closely as they are to resolve an unsolvable problem and without the loads and loads of money. And I'm, as far as plunge pools and 20-inch culverts and drainage ditches and paved and unpaved and guardrails, and I'd be willing to hear what anyone else has to say about that.
I guess I'd like to ask Mr. Frustaci if he has any response to the T.Y. Lynn letter of June the 9th.
Gotcha.
I'm still thinking about it. Not your comments, but the letter. There's an awful lot here on this culvert. We had the site walk, and it's not an easy problem. What we proposed is increasing the culvert to a 15-inch in size, 15 inches in size. That's upgrading from a 10-inch size. And running a ditch, shaping the ditch from Rosewood Drive, right here, down to where the water overflows from the pond when there's water in it. And then we're going to be building the ditch, I think, according to the plans that you have before you. The only comments, and correct me if I'm wrong, Courtney, the only suggestion that he made, or the change, was instead of paving the area, the ditch on Mr. Davis's land, is to put in the plunge pool, which is, I found out, is larger rocks. And I've got to agree with it, because if you put in a ditch and pave it, you're going to be wiping out a lot of trees. And this was not a concern of the engineers at the time. They were worried about erosion control and taking care of the water once it comes across the street. I've got no problem with this compromise, and that being the plunge pool and putting the riprap around the openings and the outlets of the culverts. And I think that's what is the summary of the letter was.
That would actually be on Mr. Davis's property.
I wish I could be left
pool,
on
right?
$2 million. I'm sorry.
Am I correct on that?
Yes.
Yes.
And how does he, and has he agreed to that?
We have a letter from his engineer, and basically he's agreed to it. Mr. Davis was notified last week. I hand-delivered the design. Our engineer's designs to his engineer, Mr. DeLuca, and I believe Mr. Davis came in earlier this week to pick up his plans on the drainage ditch. My conversations with him prior to his physically seeing the plan was he was in agreement with it, and I'm sure that if Mr. Davis was opposed to what we're doing, he'd be here this evening.
I have a question. Yes. Mr. Frasasha, was there a reason why the proposed culvert was 15 inches instead of 18 inches?
That's all that it would handle. That's all that the culvert on Mr. Davis's land would handle. We could not.
Which is an 18-inch culvert, right?
His is a 24-inch culvert, but his is an 18. Mm-hmm. His is an 18 also. Then okay, and it's all the water that it would handle.
I'll trust the engineer. I just couldn't see the rationale if they're both the same pitch. Why the velocity of water doesn't?
Well, there's more water. There was more water coming from the Davis land. Once it's not just
additional
the water
flows,
from the other side of Woodland Road.
Okay.
And yeah, there's more water coming.
I stopped at the site this noontime, and as far as I could see, whether it's a paved drainage ditch or cobbled, it's only going to really disturb one tree that is more than 4 inches thick at chest height. The rest are all 1-inch saplings on the Davis property. And actually, either method could go around that tree with relative ease. The plunge pool, and I do actually know what it is, I think there is a large pine tree about 6 feet from where the culvert comes out right now, and I think a plunge pool would actually go into the root system of that more than a simple paved drain. I keep it as simple as possible. I think Mr. Malley is very knowledgeable in that and would trust whatever's acceptable to him.
Just to the board, I believe that the town engineer raised the issue of a catch basin. The public works director did call me this afternoon and said that the town would be willing to provide that catch basin.
Oh, that's the one. We're doing the pipes, the culvert.
We're going to give him the culvert
pipes.
And the
and
catch
we're also
basin.
Giving them the catch basin.
And he gets to install them.
Such a deal.
Thank you. I did have that someplace.
I had a couple of questions.
Yes.
Still dealing with drainage, but dealing with the 50-foot section or so of Rosewood Drive as it approaches Woodland. The engineer suggests a culvert. When we were on the site walk, we talked about, and I don't remember the term.
Yeah.
When the road itself follows the pitch of the pitch of the ditch. Dip. How's that?
Swale.
That's a technical term. It looks like the drawing is set that you're not proposing a culvert for there, and that the drive actually follows like a 1 foot drop from the crown of the road to the ditch and then starts its rise back. I was looking at the profile of...
Yes, we're not proposing a culvert underneath Rosewood Drive. Mm-hmm. The ditch would start right at the side of Rosewood Drive and be reshaped according to the town, the Public Works Director, Mr. Malley.
Okay. I think he sort of, Mr. Malley preferred the ditch dip.
The dip.
Right.
Right. So if any water, it wouldn't dam up the water on the other side, right, and it would be able to flow. Right.
The engineer's letter mentions a benchmark at 2 plus 50 of Rosewood. Can you point out where that is, Maureen? It talks about a culvert at that point. Are you familiar with what I'm...
Yeah.
I only see the 90, where it refers to...
Right in between lots 1 and 2, he's talking about that culvert.
Right
at the property line, just about, between lots 1 and 2, going through the wetland.
Yeah, the reason I'm spending time on this is that a proposed motion that we have includes 2, 3, and 4 of this, of the engineer's comments, and I'm not sure that I agree necessarily the applicant...
This has been brought up a few times by T.Y. Lynn. We think that he's just misinterpreting the plan. The way our engineer explained it is that this is actually a valley occurring right there at that point. This water is coming down this way, and this is coming down this way. Both waters are flowing this way into a culvert and then out that way.
Which way? I'm sorry. Oh.
They're coming here.
You're right.
And then out that way. T. Mylin's concern was that the water was coming here, it wouldn't get into the culvert, and it was just going to keep going out. We think that he just could miss this contour may not have been labeled to show that that's actually going downhill that way. We think that's the problem. We tried to talk to him today, but he wasn't in.
Yeah, I think that is a concern if you're not going to culvert the westerly side of Rosewood. You know, in other words, you've got to pick up the drainage back there, and then that's all I would be concerned that the engineer's letter appropriately addresses the drainage at that point.
Are you referring to the culvert on Rosewood Drive and Woodland
Yes.
Road?
Yes. Well, I'm referring to both of them, that if that's not properly designed, then you're going to have a problem on the westerly side of Rosewood Drive, according to the plan.
On this side here. Well, most of the water on the other side, on the lower side, once you get over the crest going into Rosewood,
right,
would be drained down here to the culvert. Right? Mm-hmm. The other water would come out to Woodland, and then would kind of gradually
flow to the.
You would have the dip, and they would kind of gradually go across. Mm-hmm. But it would probably, we could design it to have it slope towards the pond side.
Two other questions I have on your notes on the plan. Note number 11 states, if any lots are added to Rosewood Drive, a fire hydrant must be installed and water line upgraded to 8. I'll ask both the applicant and our town planner. I guess we're covered with that. I was concerned about lots being added anywhere in the subdivision may require additional water or hydrant supply, but you'd have to come back to the planning board for any additional lots anyway. Okay. Another just a technical question on number 14. Do you mean, and I know again your intent is correct, but the blasting contractor hired by the developer must be insured for $1 million. To ask for the consensus of the board, should you be more specific about what type of coverage versus life insurance I think it's important because it's been a real concern of the abutters, and it should be a concern. It's a ledge-filled lot. Maureen?
I just want to point out that the town has a requirement that if you're going to blast, you have to get a permit from the dispatcher, and at that time you have to prove insurance
Is there a level of insurance required by the town?
There is a level. I don't recollect what it is, but...
What type of insurance? Commercial liability?
Actually, if I remember correctly, it is specified different amounts that you have to have. You may want to refer to your earth materials removal permit process. It's in the zoning ordinance.
That would be exciting.
Yes, it is. But that talks about two different types of insurance and what the minimum levels must be. It's the same when you use every January.
No, that's right.
The purpose of putting that in was just...
Yeah, the one thing that permit process the town has doesn't do is it doesn't require a blaster to do any videotaping prior to doing the blasting.
Question on the public access waiver issues, the lots 2, 3, and 4. As far as turnaround, I don't think that's an issue that is covered. I guess I'd just ask the applicant, number 2 in the engineer's letter does address that issue will be satisfied. Number 1, Maureen, has the fire chief indicated approval of the plan for turnaround, or the applicant, can you explain how that's going to be achieved?
I have to apologize that the acting fire chief has reviewed the plan and has approved it with 3 conditions, which have been reflected by notes on the plan. And then I hadn't forwarded his memo to the town engineer, and I believe that's why he's continuing to raise these issues, that he wasn't aware that the review by the fire chief had been done.
Is the only issue note number 3, covered by note number 3?
There was an issue of the driveway width and the cleared width. There was also an issue of the size of the water main, that if more than 4 lots were going to be served on Rosewood Road, that the water main would have to be increased from 4 inches to 8 inches, and also that if there were more than 4 lots on that road, that there would have to be a hydrant placed on the road.
Okay. That's all the questions I have. I think.
I've just had a chance to review briefly the removal of earth materials part of the zoning ordinance. I don't find anything that has to do with liability insurance. In order to move the... I don't know whether anybody else on the board has any further comments. I suppose I could make a motion to get us started further, but go right ahead.
I don't want to discourage you from making a motion, but just before you do, I've been looking at the stormwater control ordinance. Section 18 of our ordinances. Maureen, are you satisfied that the there's language in that ordinance that refers to the fact that the property needs to accommodate 25-year storm events and so forth? Have we adequately taken into account that I haven't seen any reference to that particular section in any of our materials, and it isn't in part of the it isn't in the in the number of permits that we have considered here under our agenda. It's not a subdivision review, wetlands alteration permit, or public access waiver, but it is an approval under the stormwater control ordinance. And we're reviewing these plans, and the project will not accommodate water from a 25-year storm for a number of very good reasons. They're justifiable. Are you satisfied that ordinance is
I don't have to be satisfied. You do. The stormwater ordinance is referred to in the subdivision ordinance, so you can use anything in the stormwater ordinance. But the subdivision ordinance also gives the board leeway to waive or modify requirements as they deem necessary. So if you feel that there are good reasons to not meet that 25-year storm requirement, then you certainly have the authority to approve the subdivision with a stormwater design that doesn't accommodate the 25-year storm. And I guess the only other comment is that typically the board relies very heavily on the recommendations of its town engineer in implementation of the stormwater regulations.
I would also add that, certainly is my apprehension, is that this proposed development has the great misfortune of being in a place that has bad stormwater problems, and that the actual effect of the subdivision is virtually minimal. It's existing because of the road, it's existing because of lots of other things that are technically outside of Mr. Fusacci's realm. And that I guess I feel that we have reached as good a compromise that the town has no money for public works, which is probably where it should be taken care of. A neighbor across the street who was bearing the brunt of all this, to try to come to at least some sort of stopgap. It'll only flood, we don't have as much as we do. I just think we've done the best that we can.
I just wanted to make sure that the record was clear that we are that there are good reasons for not accommodating a 25-year storm. In this case, one of the major reason being that the project will not increase flows it will only increase flows to a very minor extent, and will accommodate the increased flows as best he can, but cannot accommodate pre-existing conditions.
The board may want to include just such a statement in its findings of fact, actually.
Okay. I have a motion for the board to consider. Findings of fact. Joseph Fustacci is proposing Rosewood, a five-lot subdivision located in the area of Mitchell and Woodland Roads, which requires minor subdivision review, a wetlands alteration permit, and public access waivers in accordance with Section 16-2-3 of the Subdivision Ordinance and Sections 19-3-9-3 and 19-4-2-B of the Zoning Ordinance. 2. The application was deemed complete at the March 17, 1992 meeting of the Planning Board, and public hearings were held at the regularly scheduled April and June meetings of the Planning Board, 1992. 3. Easement language must be revised to be in a form acceptable to the town attorney to protect conservation land, assure provision of pedestrian easements, and provide adequate access for proposed lots in accordance with Section 16-3-1J, L, and Q, and Section 19-4-2B of the town ordinance. 4. Numerous revisions to the plans are required to minimize the impact of increased stormwater flows in accordance with Section 16-3-1I. 5. A performance guarantee is required to ensure that site improvements will be constructed to town standard and that the approved plans in accordance with Section 16-2-3A8. 6. Thomas Powers, Esquire, representing Mr. and Mrs. Michael Siepert, with land in the vicinity of Lot 5, has indicated the intent of his clients to file a quiet title action with respect to the continuation of the Edgewood Road way into the land, the subject of the subdivision. 7. The board finds that because of the minimal impact that the proposed subdivision will have on increasing storm water flows and runoffs in the area, that there's good reason not to require that the project meet the 25-year standard. Help me out on that one. What's the proper terminology?
25-year storm.
Stormwater standard?
Yeah.
Fine. 8. The application substantially complies with the requirements of the Subdivision Ordinance, Section 16-2-3, and Sections 19-3-9 and 19-4-2B of the Zoning Ordinance. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Joseph Fustacci for minor subdivision approval, a wetlands alteration permit, and public access waivers for Rosewood, a five-lot subdivision located off of Woodland and Mitchell Roads, be granted, subject to the following conditions. One, that the plans be revised to reflect turnaround and stormwater runoff concerns indicated in the town engineer's letter dated June the 9th, 1992, which is will be attached to this proposed decision, to the satisfaction of the town engineer and the public works director, and that the plans be revised to reflect construction details indicated in item 3 of the town engineer's letter of June the 9th, 1992, to the satisfaction of the town engineer. Second, that executed conservation, pedestrian easement, right-of-way, and other deeds be submitted in a form acceptable to the town attorney. Third, that a performance guarantee be submitted in a form and amount acceptable to the town manager and the town attorney prior to any alteration on the site. Fourth, that note 9 on the plan be clarified to along the lines suggested by board member Edsel, the wording to be finally approved to the satisfaction of the town planner. And fifth and last, that note 14 on the plan with respect to blasting be modified to reflect the requirement of $1 million of commercial liability insurance. I willingly accept any proposed amendments.
I'll second the motion, and congratulations on that motion.
Is there any discussion?
You need to second.
I just
said. Sorry.
That came before the congratulations.
Ms. Lardner?
One minor comment on the motion is proposed, and then a comment on this whole thing in general. On the second finding of fact, I think it would be nice if we included that we did have or reopen the public hearing also at the May meeting. There has been a lot of public input.
I beg your pardon. Yes, I meant to say that the public hearing was, if I can amend my own motion, initially held on April the 21st, 1992, reopened and continued at the May meeting and again and finally closed at the June 16th, 1992 meeting.
Okay, my comment to the board in general, it seems like I usually can't vote on the things I feel most strongly about, so I'd like to make a plea to the board. I think this is one of those situations where the conditions are so wide open and so large that we are almost neglecting our duty in the approval. If you read clearly what the town engineers recommending, it includes such things as doing the design of the new drainage facility should also include a study of the impact that the new drainage facilities would have on those areas downstream. Typically a study is done and then you get results and you say, this is not appropriate and so forth. These are very wide-ranging recommendations he's making. And I can appreciate the board's concerns that we have a bad situation here and we certainly don't want the applicant to have to fix it. That's not appropriate. On the other hand, however, often development is not allowed if it's a problematic situation. I do not think Mr. Frestacci has a situation here that cannot be remedied, and I'm not saying that he should remedy this so that the 25-year storm standard can be met. However, the town engineer, Public Works, and I think the board agree that some roadside improvements, some culvert improvements and so forth are required. I, for one, it's not clear to me exactly what the final recommendation is on this ditching and culverting. When I look at the stormwater erosion control plan, it's not clear to me that there is that dip in the driveway, although it seems like in the roadway profile that the dip is there. I also feel very uncomfortable with doing this culverting to across the road to a culvert that is on private property without any legal agreement or some understanding from Mr. Davis that the improvements, I understand, on his property are acceptable. I don't see anything on our plan, and it might be my problem, that what those improvements are on his property, for instance, the paved ditch. I was reading the letter from Michael DeLuca with respect to the proposed alternatives, and it seems to me his understanding of the town engineer's proposal is that an 18-inch culvert be put in, but not at the proposed elevation that Mr. Frestacci is proposing, but at the existing elevation, and I don't think that's the case. I think this is one of those cases where these technical details are very complex and really need to be worked out prior to approval. I'm confident that they can be worked out. I don't see this as something that would stop Mr. Frestacci, but it seems like it would be putting incredible pressure on town staff to deal with complex issues in case there are disagreements about whether there are plunge pools or what elevation the culvert is at. And I think I'll stop. I think the board understands my point.
Thank you. Do you have any other comments from the board? Mr. Ratz,
short
I know
comment.
You always do.
Just in response to that, you know, there's 2.5 pages of comment on just the stormwater runoff in the engineer's report, T.Y. Lynn letter. I'll defer to Maureen, our planner, how comfortable staff feels in reviewing that as a condition, and perhaps give us some advice. Does staff, if we're considering the engineer, the applicant, and I would hope, though I don't remember that Ms. McKay included our Mr. Malley, whatever
yes,
his title is.
Yes, Public Works Director.
Public Works Director. Whether that's a reasonable forum to come to a settlement.
Yes, as a planner, my preference is always to have the conditions be as clear as possible and to leave as few decisions as possible to town staff. It would be preferable to have this more fully designed so that some of the decisions you're concerned about would not be up to the town engineer and the public works director and myself. It's really a question for the board. There are some areas where I think in terms of review of easement deeds, review of performance guarantees, it's fairly standard and routine and something that staff is used to handling. I think you're correct that engineering work can significantly change what was previously approved. I guess, you know, it's up to the board to decide how comfortable you are with the discussions. You have been out to the site twice. I think the other comment that Ms. Larder made about the impact on the abutters' property is a good comment. We have been working with Mr. Davis. He has received a copy of the plans and has chosen to provide a letter from Mr. DeLuca for tonight's meeting. He hasn't provided us with anything more than that that talks about a specific agreement to this proposal.
And I would also like to note that Mr. DeLuca's letter, which is dated yesterday, indicates in the last paragraph that he suggests that perhaps a meeting at the site with everybody involved might be the way to resolve this thing. So there's no, I don't know how much we can read into the fact that Mr. Davis hasn't showed up tonight. I wouldn't be willing to read into it very much.
Mr. Davis did leave a note saying that he wasn't here tonight due to an illness in the family, what it's worth.
But at the same point, we also have not heard from Mr. Davis since the first time he spoke to the board, raising this issue as a large issue. To my knowledge, we haven't heard from him since. And I read this letter from Mike DeLuca that states also you could let the planning board make the decision. While I said there's 2.5 pages of commentary in the engineer's letter, a lot of it just states technical data about water flow. I would like to think, and we've gone over the past few years back and forth between whether we approve site plans or subdivisions with conditions or without conditions, that they're completely wrapped up before we give our approval to them. Or do we approve in the interest of time with conditions? I would like to think that this issue of drainage is not a difficult issue to resolve. And while there's a lot of commentary on it, I don't think that the problem, we're not going to solve the problem of the 25-year storm drainage issue completely. I think everybody that's written on that has agreed to that. At the same time, there is a proposed partial solution or improvement to that problem with a 15-inch culvert, and I would hope that would be set at a depth that's approved by Mr. Malley, who will have to maintain it in the future and have to hook it into the catch basin, and an acceptable resolution to how the water flows from that culvert to the 18-inch culvert on the Woodlands property on the south side of Woodland Road. I don't think that's a difficult issue. There seem to be two proposed plans, and you pick one or the other. I guess as one board member, I don't have a problem with the conditions set forth in the motion.
Ms. Lardner,
and I don't know that Maureen could answer this. As far as I understand, the only thing the applicant is going to have to do now is install the culvert of a size and at a particular depth, because he does indicate the invert elevations in and out of these culverts. Basically, ending at a culvert that will discharge just the Woodland Road side of Mr. Davis's property. If no improvements are done on Mr. Davis's property, which I believe he would have every right to prohibit, there quite possibly could be a flooding problem if no improvements are done.
On Mr. Davis's property?
Yes.
There's going to be water entering his property. If the plunge pool isn't done, what you're probably going to have happen is a significant amount of erosion of that slope as a lot more water comes running through the pipe, hits his property. That would probably be your biggest problem. If you don't construct a plunge pool or some kind of ditch that guides things, you may have a wider area of that depressed area on his land become wet.
I guess then my final question or concern to the board is, knowing our history with Mr. Davis, are we willing to take a risk on an unresolved plan? Because I believe he would not hesitate to take the town or whomever he deems appropriate to court because of damage done to his property. I just feel uncomfortable because I don't feel the drainage is resolved.
I think it's part of the record that he requested that we do this. And it's been his choice not to show at the meetings. Follow that up.
May I jump?
I can just jump in for a second. I just wanted to mention that the improvements that are proposed are within an easement that already exists on Mr. Davis's property that has been there as a drainage easement since he's owned the property.
Improvements are not shown on the plans, are they? What improvements will be done within that drainage?
On which plans?
On the plans the board is acting on tonight.
Yes, they are on these
plans.
Where
are the ones on his property shown? Either the paved ditch or the plunge pool?
Courtney, while you're looking, also, isn't it true that the drainage easement would be in favor of improvements constructed by the town and not improvements constructed by adjacent landowners? I mean, the drainage...
I didn't catch your question.
I'm just trying to think about the... I suppose it's useless to speculate, but I don't know what the specific language is on the drainage easement and how it would be described in terms of...
On page three, the details page on the top shows the proposed ditch that is in this proposal. The plunge pool was suggested by T. Wyland. That's not shown on here. We are showing what the SJR Engineering has proposed for this.
Madam Chair,
I think I'm going to let it go. The board knows my opinion on that.
Okay. Maureen?
To add a little more fuel to the fire, in reference to the easement that the town currently has, Mr. Davis, I have it in hand. Item 5 in that easement states that the town shall indemnify and hold the grantors, their heirs, and assigns harmless from any and all claims which may be asserted by other landowners in the vicinity by reason of the flooding of their land by waters passing through any pipes, culverts, or ditches as a result of the use of said storm drainage easement as a water conduit. In other words, if this doesn't work, the town's liable.
Okay. Do we have any other comment? I have one I'd like to add as a possible extension of condition number 1, which I couldn't begin to quote, which was that the plans be revised to reflect the items relative to the stormwater and turnaround concerns of the town engineer's letter. And I believe Janet went on to mention something about paragraph 3. And I would add that an agreement with Mr. Davis relative to the stormwater easement be executed in a form acceptable to all parties. And that, accept that as an amended motion.
Jen, you accept it, but do you agree with it? I mean, do you think that serves a purpose that... I mean, the reading of that sort of stopped me in my tracks for a second, so to speak.
I must say, and I don't mean to take any more time than is necessary, that this is probably one of the closest issues that I have had to vote on in my time on the planning board. I think that Ms. Lardner really was quite eloquent in her suggestion to all of us that there is a fine line between moving things along and deferring things to an attorney of a very technical nature or deferring things to the town manager with respect to the amount of a proposed performance bond. I think that I am more troubled now than I was when I made the motion about the deferral of things, specifically the drainage issue and specifically issues of appearance, which we are quite concerned about, and we normally require cross sections and, you know, what things are going to look like. It's a judgment call, but I suppose I accept the chair's proposed amendment to the motion. I guess I can also say that at this point I would intend to vote against the motion.
As the chair, I have no problem with this. Let's just vote on it. We all have our feelings about it, whether they're strong or not. We have come through some discussion at this point. We don't have to have everything be an automatic unanimous vote from this board. We have the authority to say no and have them come back next month if that's the way we feel. In which case,
My suggestion, and again, not to beat a dead horse, perhaps it's a very live horse, I don't know. I suspect that it's going to take Mr. Frustaci some time to, no matter whether we approve tonight or approve a month from now, with whatever conditions there are, assuming that it will be approved, I suspect that Mr. Frustaci is going to be able to use the time in between in the next 30 days to good advantage one way or the other.
Right, we have a motion before us that's been seconded.
As amended.
As amended. All those in favor of the motion as seconded and amended, signify by raising your right hands. Vote is 2. All those against? It fails, 3-2. Do we have... Do you want to make another motion? Steve, did you say? Do we have another motion?
I have a motion for the board to consider. Be it ordered based on the plans and the materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Joseph Fustashi for minor subdivision approval, the wetlands alteration permit, and public access waivers for Rosewood, a five-lot subdivision located off Woodland and Mitchell Road, be tabled until our regular July meeting. I think I'll stop right there.
Do you want to say with the consent of Mr. Fustashi?
With the consent of the applicant.
Do we have a second?
Second.
All those in favor?
No.
I'm sorry, discussion? I have to. Okay.
Is it possible to consider the wetland alteration permit and public, I believe it's a public access permit at this time, and not the overall plan? I'm asking for access to over the first portion of the wetlands.
As far as I'm concerned, there's unless
we
I'm
had
wrong,
three we had three requests.
You have three requests, but right. How can you have the second and third without the approval of the first?
I will not seek the subdivision as proposed, but I will have the opportunity to start my house. This has been my desire all along, and it has evolved to what we have, or what we presented this. But it's more important for me to build my house than it is to go through the subdivision review. We're into July. My family is too large for my house now, and I bought this land to build on, and that is my intent. That is my request, has been my request. There are several issues that have been brought up that seem to be prolonging the application, and quite honestly, it may not be resolved next meeting. So I would like to have the access, the public access and the wetlands alteration permit. I guess
just in discussion, it becomes an issue dealing with performance guarantee. But at the same time, the applicant right now just has one large lot, and if the applicant, I guess, chooses, I'd ask our planner, if the applicant simply decides to put in his own driveway that happens to be in the same path of the right of way to his own home, does that inhibit or inhibit the approval of the subdivision on a lot that's already started to be approved for one home?
To start, I would be very concerned with any action the board took tonight that was on changes to a plan that you haven't seen. So, I mean, if you're talking about modifying the subdivision or eliminating it, that's not a plan that's before the board. However, if the applicant wanted to formally withdraw their subdivision application and then go ahead and apply to the town for a building permit, they still need the wetlands alteration permit. And we'd be looking at a different kind of public access waiver. I would be concerned with any kind of application where you didn't even have a plan of what was proposed before you.
I agree.
So basically, I'm dead in the water. I cannot start the construction of my house. And I can't get to the land where I want to build.
Delayed.
It's delayed.
Delayed and delayed and delayed.
I guess I don't understand why.
Well,
the applicant has a single lot and simply chooses to put his home on the lot.
He would have to go to get a building permit. Let's go back and erase it clean. He has to go to get a building permit. And then if he's going to put the road...
It's a matter of comparing time frames.
Yeah. He could put the road around it, but then it won't be where it was. If he's going to put it in that place, then he needs a wetlands alteration permit, which means he needs a site plan showing it as just a wetlands alteration permit, right? So it's a technicality, but we need your approval to table it to the next meeting.
I guess it'd be foolish not to give it to you.
Okay, all those in favor of the motion is made, approved, and agreed to, all signify by raising your right hands. All those against? None. It passes unanimously. The next order of business tonight is Rams Head Subdivision, a request by Shaw Sprague for minor subdivision review of Rams Head, a four-lot subdivision located south of Ram Island Farm, for a public hearing in accordance with Section 16-2-3A of the subdivision ordinance. And I will excuse myself and appoint Janet McKay, chair, in my stead.
The next order of business is the application for minor subdivision review and a wetlands alteration permit with respect to Ram's Head, a four-lot subdivision at the end of Charles F. Jordan Road. Plan was deemed complete at the last meeting. Public hearing has been scheduled for this evening. Mr. Hare, you want to make any kind of opening presentation?
Not really.
Fair enough. Moving right along.
Moving right along.
Are there any members of the public here tonight that wish to speak at the public hearing? I'd like to open the public hearing at this point. Anybody wish to speak? Hearing none, I hereby close the public hearing. Okay. The board may begin review of the project. As indicated in the town planner's memo to us, the applicant has elected not to resubmit plans for this particular meeting, would intend to revise plans based on perhaps comments this evening. So, who would like to speak? Anyone? Ms. Lardner?
Just for purposes of getting the discussion going, in the town planner's memo, there was a reference to the town attorney's comments, which are also attached, and they seem to be very technical and legal in nature, and I assume that there are no problems with addressing those comments. Is that correct?
No, no problems at all. You're referring to the latest. What date was
I'm looking at his June 8th letter, which talks
right.
about
water and access.
Yes, and it sounds like it's just things that need to be taken care of, and there's no concern on the part of the applicant.
Right. Rick is handling the right-of-way issues, which have seemed to have no problems whatsoever. The water issue, we have agreed to. We're going to drill wells in lots 1 and lot 4. Lot 2, we've had the well tested, and the water standards are above main standards. So each lot will be receiving its own water, with the estate keeping its water supply from the existing well. So technically, nothing's going to change. The new lots are going to receive their own water.
Is there any concern on the applicant on correctly labeling the wetland protection zones?
No, that was a good point you made. I labeled it resource protection because the line shows up on the zoning map, and basically I went out to find that line under the assumption that we're not going to do anything with the remaining acreage. We'll be happy to change that to critical wetland. The definition is critical wetland. We're handling it the same way.
Ms. Lardner, would you be willing to serve as a voting member for this particular issue?
Sure.
Thank you. Anybody else?
I would just ask that if you could indicate, and so I don't have to unfold my map here, where the area will be changed to critical wetlands, the dunes area?
Well, this right here is the line that we've been calling RP, which is a critical wetland zone, just by definition, the ordinance that we're working under.
So everything from that green line to the waterfront?
Yes, it is undeveloped, undisturbed, forever natural.
Just for the board's information, at the time this was reviewed, this was under the old ordinance, and technically the name of that zone is the critical wetland zone. Under the new ordinance, which doesn't apply to this particular development, that's now called the Resource Protection 1 Critical Wetland Zone. So I believe that the town attorney's comments were basically to make sure the labeling was exactly as stated in our own ordinance.
But to the old ordinance?
Right. Either the old or the new. We just don't have a resource protection zone. We have either a critical wetland zone or a Resource Protection 1 Critical Wetland Zone.
Question to our planner. Are there any particular concerns at this point?
I believe that the issues that were originally raised were related to the location of, or related primarily to water, to whether or not the applicant was going to be applying for a wetlands alteration permit. The applicant has since indicated where the water is going to be for each lot in relation to the septic system. He has provided information about where replacement systems could be provided for the lots that are essentially developed at this stage. And he's also agreed that in lieu of providing additional information on the vegetation on the site, that they're just going to call all the Nomberg soil poorly drained and label it a wetland protection zone. So those issues have been resolved.
So at this point, it's a matter of revising the plans and the board making a final vote on it next meeting?
Yes. The one other piece that should be coming soon is, because they're asking for a wetlands alteration permit, typically the board will receive the comments from the Conservation Commission, and they are planning to have their comments available to you prior to the next meeting.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other comments from board members?
Just as a comment, I would ask that the rest of the board try to take a long, hard look at this tonight. If we do choose to table, that we are, again, left with lots of conditions. So that's very clear to the applicant, so we don't bounce back again. I personally, as one board member, the site walk, even though I was there for a limited amount of time, clarified a lot of issues. With a fairly complex piece of land quite quickly for myself.
Mr. Hare, does the applicant have any particular questions that it would like further elucidation from the board on?
Rick?
My name is Rick Cheney. I represent Mr. Sprague. Just two things. I've talked with Mike Hill on his letter and explained to him that the issues he's raised with respect to the easement relocation agreement will be clarified, that the two drafts that you have, the easement relocation agreement and the declaration, are simply drafts. They're going to be revised and you'll have final forms before your next meeting. I didn't want to spend any more time changing or modifying till we had your comments. And those of the corporation. And we've had the corporation's comments, and they have no particular concerns. The meeting of the corporation to decide to agree on signing the easement relocation is in July, July 17th. So the timing works out well because we have your comments. And we will be revising and finalizing and getting you those forms, plus clearing them with the corporation's counsel, Chuck A. Stryker, Vero and Daner. So we would expect by the next meeting that you will have the final agreements to go along with the final plan, so that you'll have a complete application documents for voting on.
Mr. Cheney, could I ask you, has there been any further discussion with respect to Lot 4 and the restriction or the conservation easement with respect to that lot?
You mean in terms of the not building discussion with whom? No, I haven't really. The only thing I've said is in my letter to Maureen that we would presume that the final plan would include an appropriate condition prohibiting or limiting construction or building of any sort within that area, and I'm simply intending to incorporate the conditions on the final plan in all the deeds, so by reference, the restrictions will be applicable.
Anybody else have any further comments?
In our package for the May meeting, we had the town engineer's comments that centered on water supply, which was asking for additional data be submitted, I think, to code enforcement. Is our code enforcement officer comfortable with that?
Yes.
Then the other thing is he did have some comments about, I'm looking on page 2 of the May 12th memo, about the configurations for driveways not being exactly those shown on another plan, and they should be revised, and a typical section of the proposed driveway to be built on Naumburg soil should be added to the plans for review. I assume all these will be accomplished as part of this revision right now?
Absolutely.
Okay, so there are no questions with anything you've received from town staff to date?
Right. The driveway locations he was mentioning, and it was a good point, is, you know, it's a very valid remark on the turning, the entering, the exiting of emergency vehicles. And I supplied to Maureen turning radiuses and diagrams showing a fire truck getting in and out of every single lot. And there were some revisions that needed to be made in a couple of these little triangles, and those will be shown on the final plan that will be presented for next month.
And then I think the last comment I would have is on the sidewalk, Mr. Emery had proposed some sort of common area that would encompass the pond. And I think it was you who indicated that that would not be the preference of the applicant. But if you could explain for the board one more time, what exact mechanism are you proposing so no one lot owner could really impinge on the quality of the pond for other lot owners?
Okay. Just to get you up to speed. The,